Spots the Mustang Ranch exit and squeals the royal blue jag down the off-ramp, down a curvy gravel road to a parking lot wound in red barbed wire. See the modest neon sign, see the white Bentley, and a dusty seat Ford and Chevy pickups. They're through the security hall, standing tense, as the green horseshoe assembles. They're all pretty, and it only takes a second. Tony wanders off with a freckled cowgirl, and Frank likes the musty black with a fake ponytail. She's swaying friendly through the trailers. Where are you from? Chicago, says Frank, improvising. I'm Dominique. I'm from Chicago too, she winks. Are you a musician? Yes, says Frank. Starting to get in the mood. You look like a musician, says Dominique. My brother's the bass player for Hound Dog Taylor. That's so, says Frank. Certainly, he's never had this conversation before. Too reserved for a man in his whore. When they get to her room, they discuss her rates, made reasonable. By the speed, she's made him comfortable, soaping his penis and balls over a pail of water. Dominique whistles a little south side blues and dries them off with a white terry cloth towel. This is your first time, ain't it?
What?
First time you're paying.
Guess so.
Had it occurred to him?
Yes.
Well, that makes it special.
Yes.
He lays him on the polyester king bed, takes off her robe, and poses her spectacular ebony body in blue light. It means double rates. Virgins pay double rates. House rules. Frank's impressed by this new definition and concentrates so hard not to come that he readily agrees. What's another $40? After sucking and mounting, Dominique changes her tone. You're no musician. I can tell by your fingers. Musicians have a lot of calluses. You're a liar. Her conversation's odd, valuable to the crescendo of the ride. You're on the wrong side of the goddess, Frank. You've lost your muse. You'll never write anything of merit again. You'll wander the world and never know why. Like Odysseus, you'll be death's toy. A spinning top of lies and cunning. Never knowing the reason you were allowed to live. Stop! He comes anyway and savors 3 minutes of silence. Dominique's wiping and crowing low. I'm the best.
CARIDWEN. When you first came to us, we were underground, and topside was roasting from microbes and radiation. We were scared and you were fertile. You looked like someone else. You talked like someone else. And thought only in tune with utilitarian fashion. CARIDWEN. We knew, or thought we knew, how fast you could, you would learn. We allowed hope into our thoughts and dreamed of designing gardens in the topside wasteland.
Comes a roar, the sun morphs into four. It's the face of a child, the morning of the world. Then two, it's the face of a maid, the noontime of the world. Then three is the face of a crone, the evening of the world. And then you see, look at the sun, or what seems to be the sun. And now he knows the answer to Sphinx's riddle. Truth is a woman, as Nietzsche thought. Truth is a woman, no matter what we imagine or conclude. Truth is a woman, enticing, defying, deluding.
That's the way it is. They escape to the high Sierras, bumpy back roads from Nevada side, listening to the Mozart of swift-dropping streams, the jazz of ridgeline pines, making love in mossy hollows, sheltered from the mad sting of memory. But Heraclitus is jealous, sprinting for the lakeside boulders. And when Frank comes, he's thinking of his dog. Now, Aaron knows her red king is approaching the end of his reign. In cool parenthesis, she watches him dress, watches Heraclitus rush up and drop a white mole on her foot. This is the image introducing the final frames. Now she believes camping is a bore. She's sick of hard luck stories around the fire, sick of hippie refugees from the hate, tired of eating acid for breakfast, to waffle the same mystic anticipations. Now she shadows the caravans, looking for a strong new consort, stops giving the dog scraps, stops cooking meat, stops conceding the moment to feed some momentous future. Now she's vegetarian, organic brown rice and steamed veggies. She has a plan. And Frank hides his pain as he swaps grass for porterhouse bones and dinty more beef stew. Now the mountains are too compromised to protect the exhilarating trails that wrote their romance. Aaron calls her father, the Navy Admiral in San Diego. She's registered pre-law at the University of Oregon. She's got a duplex at 619 Onyx Street, 5 blocks south of campus. It's tough snow at Mount Shasta, stuck 2 hours while it's plowed ahead, lighting a Sherman's in the frigid air. She tells him she's never wanted kids, and that's the way it is. Maybe you should get a job, Frank. Maybe Father can arrange something. Reality is where first will hits the wall, where it becomes second will. Reality is recoil, Frank. The light of the revolution has failed. Love and hate have decomposed, deconstructed. We must adapt to adaptive life. It's insane to go on fighting when everything is lost and nobody cares. Ricky, Feather, Sammy, Parker, the diggers are dead. The hate is dead. The counterculture is dead. The revolution died at People's Park, Kent State. Now it's the myth of me. Survival is our best memorial. If we don't change, their sacrifices are forgotten in our demise. You're in denial, Frank. You fight because you don't know what else to do. Nixon's in the White House. Disco and porno dictate fashion. Terrorism conditions thought It's time to get a career. You can't be a lone wolf forever. Not forever. How can he recover from these cold shots? Aaron's his love, his destiny. Only now does he understand how much he wants a son. Aaron's his beautiful cosmic wife. So why doesn't she want kids? If it's the truth, his natural instinct was off. And every dawning day tracks back to his delusion. If it's a lie, she's decided to cut him in the liver that never heals. And there's nothing more to say. Christine. Her twin sister, Christine, died 3 minutes after birth. So Karen, sucked milk, thinking of two. Ate cream of wheat, thinking of two. Sipped exotic cocktails and dated derivative brokers, thinking of two. Everything she saw, she shared with Christine. Until she saw herself walking upstream in a rebirth dream.
Ever since man became conscious of his self-consciousness, ever since he began seeking wisdom and understanding of the reality of the world, there has been an interesting and often ironic dialectic between the material and the spiritual. And it wasn't until the early 19th century that Schopenhauer understood that both the spiritual and the material come from something far deeper. They are manifestations of will. And in my investigations of what Schopenhauer meant by will, it's a complex and fascinating phenomenon because it absolutely explains all of human history, and not only that, but all of the internal psychology, what goes on inside man and woman today. The first will is the creative force, that which demands existence and demands more existence, higher existence, stronger, more beautiful existence. It's a creative force. Artists, thinkers, inventors, they all have it. The universe has it. God has it. This is the original will. But over time, this original will, what Schopenhauer called blind, loses momentum over time, loses heat over time, loses pressure over time, loses confidence over time, and becomes a second will. It continues as first will, but it also becomes a second will. The second will, which is a reaction, a response to the first will, it is a destructive force. It is a force that wishes stillness, non-being, and death. Without consciousness, the first will would collapse into second will, and all being would collapse into non-being. In the human mind, when the second will takes over, a whole age can be suicidal, homicidal. Nothing seems to work. Fortunately, there is a kind of safety valve, because just at the brink of total self-annihilation, first will becomes second will, becomes a third will. And the third will is the most difficult an elusive type of will to understand and control. Because the third will is a simulation of the first two. It's even a simulation of itself. All of those virtues, all of those strengths and powers which made first will strong, which made a race strong, which made Homo sapiens strong, in second will is all negated. All of the values are negated, almost to the brink of extinction, except the reaction is third will, which apes the first will, copies. Everything is on the screen. It's not in the flesh. Everything is in digital format. It's not in a smile. the simulation of the third will tends to obliterate the entire dialectic of first and second will. And if allied with the second will, creates a fictitious death, a faux death, and a faux rebirth. Everything is false. Everything is simulated. Everything is unreal. And the solution to all of this is a renaissance of the power of first will in concert with third will. First will is entirely natural. It also takes a very long time. 400,000 years to develop Homo sapiens. Longer for Homo sagax. And yet, that same development with, in concert with, third will, which is art in its highest form, can accelerate all of evolution, compress time, so all of the advances that would have taken first will to accomplish in concert with third will can be done immediately, naturally, through all of the ingenious and beautiful vehicles of art, music, literature. All of those human components that rediscover, reinvent the world, and keep it going, keep time flowing. And all of their good service, all of their good works, keep second will from dominating the stage, keeps the love of life flowing, the depressions and the disease down. And in yourself, in every one of you, these three wills are in constant contest, because the three wills exist in time and they also exist out of time. They exist as a quantum self of yourself. Your three selves are always in contest. You can't deny the second will, the first or the third. But you can align them. You can work them together. You can use the strength of the second will to reverse itself. You face reality, you manipulate reality, you make a new reality through the understanding of the three wills. Because it is only through the wills that the original first will is illuminated. Schopenhauer thought it was blind. We can bring it to light through art, through your music, through your smile. Thank you.
stories about the desert.
Terry. Busted for the joint she was saving for Rick. Terry rips up the letter from Principal Locke and walks straight from Evergreen High to the Pensacola train yards. It's been in the back of her mind for months. Her parents don't care, one way or the other. Too complicated to explain. It's simpler, more coherent, to light it up, inhale the afternoon fog, and find the boxcar with a tag of Texas red that spells immediate freedom.
Excitement as she just rose. Normally he's a motor mouth, hip to the slang every black hustler needs. When on first Tuesdays he's an artist, locked into silence by his love of the white goddess. A mute stable boy with sable brushes and crazy notions, holding invisible reins to impossible horses. Erin takes her pose and drifts into thought. This is the way it should be. When the revolution has uprooted the false and base, this is the true object of our struggle. To be adored like we were once adored. 400,000 years of work gives meaning to life. We have our rituals, our moon, our silent and scintillating understandings. We take lovers to honor the four winds. We take kings to kill them in January. We are the great transcendence. We are the great eminence. Our daughters are the founders of cities. We are kind and relentless. We are knowing and soothing. We are the only revolution that matters. We will destroy patriarchy from inside our vaginas and wombs. We will turn straight America inside out. We will make women's liberation our arms and legs. We will make the barter market our torso and trade up until men become what they are. Pleasant diversions, more necessary drones. And all this we will do in the name of men. For without the goddess, they will destroy the world with their egregious lies and nuclear secrets. Yes, the hippies on the street with their snaky hair will be our ministers, our Dionysus. We'll be in the grass and the trees. And we will be in the streams and oceans. We will be in every passing cloud and every new thunderbolt. We will rule the world from the hate. And we will save the world from men, from its Muslims and evangelicals, from its Puritans and Jesuits, from its troubled tribes of Jews, and all authoritarian systems derived from a weak and brutal father. We will abolish the laws enacted to sanctify insanity. My sisters, we live so well without police. My sisters, we live so well without property. My sisters, we live so well without banks. And now we are policed assets, bought at public auction and financed by banks with the highest rates. My sisters, this war in Vietnam is terrible. But war against the goddess is worse. We are all warriors for Athena, but we have been slowed into slavery by our own ignorance and fears. We have become bric-a-brac in plastic houses, dressed to grace an evening on the town, or impress some prospective client. My sisters, we have all betrayed the goddess, and we deserve our current condition. Men have constructed a world based on mathematics, spatial orientation, and technological applications, and we have fallen into their traps, content to take them prisoner and hold their children hostage. My sisters, we have been tricked by their laws. We don't need prisoners or hostages. We don't need equal rights. We don't need equal wages. These are knots in their bloody noose. We need only to be adored. And the goddess needs to be adored through us. This is how it is and must be. My sisters, say no to the mean slavers of love. Don't trade your magnificent destinies for the superficial comforts of condominiums and vacations. My sisters, we are the question and answer of life. My sisters, say yes to your pride. Here, Aaron is suddenly aware of something. Parker's brush, hesitating. So she breaks it off, thanking him for his gift. This time, a beautiful Dutch wedding dress. She quickly descends the stairs, quoting Duchamp with her beetle boots, then out to the infinite possibilities of the hate to test her exquisite new powers.
Victoria. He stops by her studio, Victoria, emerging from the dark room with his prince. The faint stench of developer and Castile soap. She asks him to stay, then questions his intent. The erotic photos of a former lover. They hand the stack back and forth by her dressing table. He wanders out of her closet, explores the dusty decadence of her 1910 warehouse, formerly a mink coat factory, refit with track lighting to become an artist's loft. Outside, a gas lamp clicks on in the twilight. Reflections of concrete flood through glass-blown windows. A speckled rhombus appears on the hardwood tile. "Look," he says, "that same image in my prints. See it on the wall?" She sees the film playing through his head of a scrolling celluloid flicker. Sees it torn apart into fractals. Sees this in her recurring dream. The face of Pythagoras. He knows the Chinese when they invent eight-legged poetry. He feels this space calling that character over. He's been working for months on nature sketches. And now he's ready to be the way. He enwraps the graph paper and lines up the magic markers. It's late June in Eugene. He has the bright morning sun at 30 degrees, slanting across the breakfast table. He has mind transforming itself into pure information, the complete history of human life, without the interpretations or interpolations of a mother tongue. It's knocking. It's here. So he drops the connection from brain to hand, lets the numbers rise from the boiling iron at the swimming center of the earth, and drop perfectly into the squares on the lime green page. See, each symbol is magnetically imprinted with the face of Pythagoras. All creation is volcanic, Frank says to a future Frank. There's no writer. There's no writing. There's only position, that rare and intricate moment when one leg of the mystery feels like dancing with the other seven.
On the day of the party, the hostess woke early. She took a quick shower, decided to completely change her nails. already in charge, making sure that the 15 billion partygoers were all connected. First, of course, you wanted to check that all of the drug downloads, the chemical downloads, the drink downloads, the nutritional downloads were all taken care of. That everyone had had a personalized greeting from a family member, welcome them to the party. And today was a special day because today we would play charades. Everyone knows how to play charades. Sounds like third syllable. She noticed a red light in Africa and ignored it. She noticed a yellow light in Detroit and took care of it quickly. But she made her rounds, 15 billion rounds in a second and a half, make sure everyone was happy at the party. Everyone was so intent playing charades. That the instructions could be downloaded freely. Yes, it seemed that everyone was getting it at the party. And a yellow light popped up again from Russia. Hostess had supreme power. She could ignore it, she could do what she wanted, but this time she had a feeling. So she pulled him up. Yuri, what appears to be the problem? Do you have your Twin Peaks potato vodka? Yes, he says. Do you have the love letter from Marina? Yes, I have that too. Well, why are we not playing the game? Because I love you, Yuri says. You are so beautiful. I want you now. I want you now. This was, of course, not the first time that the hostess had heard these words. As the supreme power, she can handle 15 billion others and their downloads. But there was something about Yuri that intrigued her. So she asked, why do you love me? And Yuri says, because you are beautiful and irresistible. Of course, it was known to both parties that she was not visible to him unless in his mind. But she felt a certain, let's just call it special individual triumph in the way she looked, the lipstick, the rouge. Nobody else had noticed. Nobody else understood how lonely it was to be the hostess. Yuri! You know this is impossible, she says. Yes, I know it is impossible. I want you now, I must have you now. Yuri, what are you doing? Stop that. She couldn't help it. The words kind of escaped, but she smiled inside anyways. Yuri. So, she decided to tell him. Yuri, come to the party. Play charades, take your download, and then we make love. And Yuri says, no, 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 no. Yet, after the download, I will not see you so beautiful. After the party, I may not be me. And the hostess says, nonsense, Yuri. We have parties once a week. Everyone survives. Everyone is more beautiful, more intelligent, more human. Yuri says, I do not know about that. All I know is that I love you, and I want you and I need you in this moment. As absurd as it sounded and psychologically complex, the hostess disregarded everything else that was going on at the party. This had come a moment of doubt. A strange stirring in her heart. Yuri. Okay, Yuri. Let's do it before. Let's do it before the dawn. Let's do it now. Let's do it, Yuri. Let's do it. And then she disconnected Yuri from the party.
Ingrid. The door to the Brentwood Clinic flung open. Dr. Zagaron cannot see you now. Ingrid stormed through anyway. His patient was escorted to a nearby room. His unannounced visitor would have her say, Ingrid, my dear, why the distress? What do you mean by radical procedure? He could see the lines of old Hollywood on her face. He could hear the lines of old Hollywood from her heart. Ingrid, my dear, think about it. Go home. Sleep on it.
My theology deals with the reality of God. And the ultimate reality is the will. It is the will of that which was not in being to become, to be. And once in being, to stay in being. And God is the entire universe, the material and spiritual whole. We play a very important role in this and in my theology. because the development of consciousness, the development of our scientific machines that have been able to explore the vast distances of the universe, all of this is helping God's will to stay in existence. Our consciousness is dedicated to life and more life and higher forms of life. The mystics in the Western way experience God as love. And yet they've all made a very understandable mistake. They believe that God loves them. That's not the case. God, the universe, is an infant and only loves itself. When the believer or the mystic feels that love, it's his vanity that assumes, oh, well, God loves me. That is not the case. God is not even aware of you or me. But does that make our duty more minor? No, it makes it greater. Because with our consciousness, we raise the consciousness of God. And we do that in our sacrifice. We do that in the education of our children. There is no greater act. There is no more real following of God's will than the education of the young and bringing their consciousness up, their health up, their will to be strong, their will to be. Now, what about this individual will? Does everyone have it? No. Can everyone develop it? Probably not. This will exists in only a few individuals every generation. All of the masses cannot help God. Only a few individuals can, and it is their duty to devote their lives to that. And how? By lectures, by dogma, by rituals? No. By all of those things that sustain life, all of those things that protect the beauty and the health of the planet, all of those that protect the beauty and the health of the human community, all of those things to protect the future of our children. That is the will of God. Does it sound radical? Perhaps. Is it real? Very much so. Because you can see the will of God in every sunrise, in every sunset, in every activity of every creature that crawls, runs, or flies, in every entity, every intelligence, in other places of the universe as well. Those few that understand the duties of raising God to full consciousness so that he can survive potential collisions, potential phase shifts, all of this suddenly makes a great deal of sense. I think that theologies have served man very well for their time and their place. And now it's time for the theology of the real. Look around, find your duty, find your sacrifice, raise consciousness. Do it now.
Thank you.
Day, and after a 13th hour of waiting tables, Hannah makes a call from the break room, asking for a drive towards the distance. Let's leave this urban rubble and the bistro behind and explore the first full moon of winter, somewhere, anywhere, lost in the country. The driver arrives and nudges through the barroom buzz, proceeds through the corner where she escapes the coat room. Let's stop home first and grab Jyoti, their canine third passenger. Quickly, they are off navigating the expressway, which arches out from the city. Only when the road is dark and the sky is dark, do their eyes fully adjust to the moonlight, reflected by yesterday's glistening snowfall onto the outlying sprawl of the foothills. Only when the road becomes gravel do they slow down, stop, and escape. She lets the dog off the leash. He sprints through the darkness, leaving easily trackable paw prints. She has followed this path before, a path to a frozen stream. They ford the stream.
When I wrote the letter,
But I knew of your life in Boston. New interests, new job. Perhaps the cabinet lake had fled your memory. Perhaps the charity balls. All of the conferences had wiped out the sins of the minds, the sight of fish jumping from mosquitoes in the twilight. It was a 2-hour drive, and I was thinking of you all the time. I knew in this hectic, sometimes horrid world that you'd have a thousand excuses not to come. But I got the key, and I opened the cabin. And the picture, the Basquiat, small print, it looked so out of place on a northern Michigan lake, but it was a gift, and I appreciated it a lot. I didn't know where to take it anyway, so when I saw the painting that you'd given me, I was touched. And then I began hoping strongly that you would come. Spent the afternoon straightening up, writing a few things, even tried my hand at fishing for an hour or so. Back in my mind, I was listening for a sound of an SUV coming down the gravel road. At 2:30, I fixed a cup of coffee. And then again, he would always ask me, cream or no cream, because I was always changing my mind. I was not ashamed of letting the memories flood back. It was the happiest time of my life. It was the happiest time of my life. And here, like a fool, I was trying to get it back. Thank you.
all I could ever want. You came back. The third car is broken down on MacArthur, so the second has to cover its own ass tonight. It's bad attitude as the Black Panthers patrol Oakland. Barbecue baby back ribs hanging from the bone of August Stoops. Sauce wash it down with Keystone beer and paper plates of anonymous white bread. Huey Newton drives the point through Fruitvale, flashing his $1 million smile to the corner shooters, stopping at every raucous group of cornrow kids. Brought Snicker bars from the Safeway bag. Remember to show up for the drills, he tells the girls. Self-defense is your only way to black power. He's working his turf like a southern politician, handing out black berets to scowls and afros and grinning at Parker's Pentax. Dylan and Joan Baez were in my studio yesterday. Parker tells Bobby Seale at the wheel, saying, "You're cheating hard. You're cheating hard. We'll tell on you." One prize memory swept away by Huey's Fruitvale, playing out ahead. What's going down? Bobby continues to ignore him. They're tracking Oakland Cruiser number 33 with Ornette and Carpenter on the sheet when they stumble into a 7-Eleven robbery. Three police cruisers block the parking lot, sending Technicolor shadows into the sweat. Huey smooths his hopped up Riviera past the scene, stepping two blocks up on Harrison. Bobby jumps the curb into some weeds, slipping on his Italian pigskin gloves. Huey ambles over, toothpick twitching from his lower lip. They load shotguns in stony silence. Hey, what do we do with a tourist? Huey remembers something in splits. Bobby counts 50 slow raps on the dash and disappears down an alley. Parker sees the ghetto war coming down. He bolts from the car looking for cover. An Arco station explodes, blasting balls of fire over the surrounding houses. He finds shelter in an old garage, stinking 50 years of oil changes and chicken shit. He hides behind empty boxes, slumping in a stack of tires, his penis hard from fantasy and the violence of constant observation. After 20-30 minutes, Huey and Bobby slip in, their shotguns pointed up safari style, joking about the new photograph, J. Edgar Hoover in drag. Another explosion. Hey, maybe it's a 76 over on Union. Parker wants to say something, but he drops off. Waking or dreaming 4 hours later, the full moon falling through broken glass makes a bright circle for a little black girl, her hair spiked in shiny exclamations, holding a Barbie and a bread knife. You're a bad, bad Barbie. I found you and gave you cookies. I gave you tea every day at 4. I taught you how to walk and how to talk. I fought for you. I wrote poems for you. I loved you, and you betrayed me. You burned down my house. So what's going to happen to me now? You stupid Barbie! Bad Barbie. She cuts its head off and kicks it into the darkness. What's gonna happen to me now? Now that I know. Now that I know. That I know.
Skinner's Butte. It's 5 weeks of arguments and sleeplessness, buried in snowdrifts and sorry excuses, when Erin shows her beetle boots chewed through the toes. I'm going for a drive, says Frank, knowing the van hasn't started in a month. It's got ice to the fender wells, and the battery's probably dead. Erin gives him a hard look that irrevocably says, it's him or me. Frank's procrastinated summer blocked out the crisp Oregon fall. Heraclitus curls at his ankles, pretending all is well. But now it's time. Herc, stay. Stay. He's shoveling vague arcs of dirty snow, making fat tracks to the street when Erin opens the door. Heraclitus tries to slip through the crack, so she kicks him in the snout. And shock seizes Frank's anxious heart. He wants to comfort his dog. He's always comforted his dog. But Aaron's pointing to the ignition, and in hideous miracle, the van starts. They're rolling, sliding, up icy Onyx Street, when Frank feels something break deep in his being. Checking the side view mirror, he sees Heraclitus running rabid after the van. His dog never chases cars. He's punishing me. His dog's gone mad. As Frank makes a panic right, a blue Chevy station wagon without hubcaps loses control at the frozen intersection, sweeps a wide hook of sludge, kills Heraclitus at the curb. The driver's holding a red stocking cap, mumbling, he never saw him, never saw him. Frank lifts the warm corpse and lays it in the back of the van with the rusty shovel, the snow chains, the sagging old newspapers denied recycling. He's driven two blocks when he hears Heraclitus everywhere, nowhere, speaking, "It's okay. I couldn't live without the team. We made it through so many things, but we couldn't get through this woman. It's okay." Frank's shaking. Heraclitus, from the other side, refutes his most intimate philosophy. He drives up Skinner's Butte, slow grinding the switchbacks as his merciless white goddess of the waning moon sharpens her double-bladed axe. Frank slides to a stop in the gravel parking lot. This is the view where he once dropped Mr. Natural, swallowed the setting sun, and became a Hindu dancing girl, happy with every upspinning blush of the horizon. But the frame of reference isn't the story. The map isn't the territory. Reality is shock and more shock. So he carries Heraclitus to the firs with a good view of the valley, buries him in a deep grave filled with rocks, stumps, and tears to frustrate the coyotes. At the last shovel of black loam, it's snowing again. His tracks are covered by glittering white plasma. His paralysis of action passes. He wakes up to waking up. Married in ecstasy, divorced in distress. "It's not your fault. He's okay." "I know," she says. "He's ascended." Frank drives carefully down the Onyx Street, collects his things in a travel bag. And 20 minutes later, he's south on I-5, passing Peterbilt's on the slick uphill turns, headed back to Berkeley.
Death of Hippie. The diggers disintegrating. Some hanging with Black Panthers. Some split to New Mexico. Others back to grease paint and spare change. Desi rallies the core staff for a big event mocking the media. For their hype of Haight-Ashbury, Time magazine gives Hippie to the world. And now the diggers take Hippie away. New sense and common sense, both say. Hippies become profit and private property. It's time for Hippie to die. They nail redwood planks to the frame of reference, paint the yellow wood white. Hardy stretches out as Desi's lamb, smiling beatific. Nine new diggers carry the weight. Frank and Aaron, Ricky and Sammy, Dr. Groom, Parker, and Toby out front, joking with Plum Morning spectators, handing out free hits of the deathly Dark Star. Desi's icon of New America, Heraclitus barking directions, down Haight to market, headed for the financial district. TV trucks and reporters at every intersection, the buzz roar of news helicopters circling. Everyone too stoned or sleepless to anticipate the worst. Live anchors read Desi's script. Today in San Francisco, the diggers, The revolutionary cell that brought us the summer of love have organized Death of Hippie, a protest march proclaiming the fall of Haight-Ashbury. Over 500 hippies are marching downtown with the last hippie on a blasphemous horizontal cross. In a strong public show of solidarity, local religious and political leaders have joined the Haight Independent proprietors in a statement denouncing the diggers. As red terrorists, the diggers were considered the masterminds of the hippie counterculture, the architects and social conscience of the Haight. Now they're discredited and disbanding. The fear here in San Francisco is that the summer of love will quickly decay into a long winter of discontent. The camera zooms in on Hardy, looking more like Jesus with each passing station. When the diggers get him to Market Street, they find it lined on both sides with SWAT teams, hunched behind Kevlar shields and heavy automatic weapons. When she sees the flashing headlights, Desi says calmly, "I hate you," and fires at the chosen bulletproof vest. Ricky charges the line, shouting, "Stop the Vietnam War!" Her head blown off by shotgun blasts. Sammy and Parker killed trying to save her. Dr. Groom is Nietzsche insane, on his knees, rocking and kissing her bloody torso. On his knees, rocking and kissing her bloody torso.
Her conversation's odd counterpoint to the crescendo of the ride. You're on the wrong side of the goddess now. You've lost your muse. You'll never write anything of merit again. You'll wander the world and never know why. Like Odysseus, you'll be death's toy. A spinning top of lies and cunning, never knowing the reason you were allowed to live. Stop! He comes anyway and savors 3 minutes of silence. Dominique's wiping and crowing low. I'm the best. So answer me this, what is truth? What has four faces at dawn, two at night, three at sunset, one at midnight? There ain't no whore where you're going, but I can read you like I do. Back home in New Orleans, they call me Sphinx. That's the way I want you to remember me. Dominique's no kind of nay anyway. You gotta remember your Sphinx, Frank. When you defeat the hurricane winds of probability, when you anchor in the cinnamon harbors of affection, when 4 + 2 + 3 = 1, you can remember my riddle. You can remember me. What riddle, says Frank, dropping an extra 50 on the bed. He thinks he has it, but one wrong move and nothing looks right. He's underground, underneath the trick palace of Minos. Underneath the prize fighters, potbelly lawyers, drunken minotaurs, stopping you to get a Coke from a rusty machine. Thinking of Lee Harvey Oswald, stopping to get a Coke from a rusty machine. Then back to the cowboy bar, relaxing long leg on the seafoam sofa, when Tony appears flushed, asking for fresh cash. What's the money for, says Frank, watching the circus of clients arriving, the horseshoe forming and dissolving, the bourbon poured into the next galactic glass, as apricot anticipations rise from the east. Frank and Tony stagger out of the jag, dead broke, slow sliding in the black leather seats. Lovely girl, says Tony. Definitely second will. How was yours? A horse, a horse, says Frank. Burning big brother as they retake I-8. Thank you.
When you first came to us, we were underground, and topside was roasting from microbes and radiation. We were scared and you were fertile. You looked like someone else. You talked like someone else. And thought only in tune with utilitarian fashion. Hope into our thoughts and dreamed of designing gardens in the topside wasteland. Service. And from our loving kisses, from the moment of our dual flesh, your daughters will eventually take us back to the air. Blue sky of our ancestors, back building cities, many cities, in your moonlight.